Hello everyone and welcome to this feature webinar of DatProf Privacy. My name is Bernd Nienhuis, I'm the Chief Product Officer at DatProf. And in this session, we will take a look at the world of synthetic data generation and in particular the features we have in DatProf Privacy for this. So synthetic test data is everywhere right now. Data masking and data subsetting is old news. Everything will be replaced with synthetic data. At least, this is what most vendors will tell you, right? And even if there are struggles, artificial intelligence will solve it. Sounds familiar? Well, let's take a look at the most common arguments for synthetic data generation. The first one is obvious. Your security officer denied all use of existing data for other than production usage. So the only option is to generate data. The second argument for synthetic data is that your production data does not cover all your test cases. You really want to just generate those specific data that you require for your test cases. The third argument is that setting up a test data environment costs too much time and too much money, especially when you are dependent on large copies of your production database. And the last argument is obvious. If there is no data available, for example, you are developing a new system, there isn't any production data that you can use as test data. In that case, the only option you have left is generate synthetic data. Well, often synthetic data is compared or placed as an alternative to masked or anonymized data. But is it really a fully alternative? With synthetic test data, you try to reproduce real data as best as possible. But when you are not using any production data at all, you have to generate all of the data, not only the parts that are privacy sensitive. With masked or anonymized data, you take a copy or a subset of your production database and manipulate only a fraction of the data to make it anonymized. And this is not always a simple process, and it will probably affect more attributes than you can currently think of. But it's still a fraction of the production data that you have to edit. When choosing a test data strategy, underestimating the complexity of your test data is one of the biggest reasons a synthetic data generation project will fail. When thinking about generating synthetic data, you probably think of some customers, some contracts, some orders, really what you see on the left side, a really simple data model with some tables and some relationships between them. But on the right side, you see reality. And reality, this is an example, only 10% maybe of a real data model of an ERP system that we subset and mask. But it's far more complex than you can think of. And when you have to generate all of those data, it becomes really complex. And it becomes complex on the smallest level. So if you would generate it and you would generate it all, you have to specify and configure all of the different properties for each attribute. So it has to comply with your data types, the length, the precision. But data can also have functional requirements. So for example, a date of birth can be in the future. And then a date field has some functional properties and it cannot be generated into the future. So you have to specify that into the generator. Data can also be dependent on each other. So for example, if you have a start time and an end time, those attributes are dependent on each other. Historical data is also often very hard to generate. So let's say you want a customer with like 30 years of history. That becomes really challenging in generating all those different history records for that customer. Also, data quality issues that occur in your database, in your production database, and you want to reproduce those data quality issues into your test data, that can also be time consuming to configure all those specific parts inside your synthetic data generation tool framework. In the end, it requires lots of knowledge on how your data and your application is working. So you may think of this, you may think at the moment, why would I even consider synthetic data generation? Well, I can understand that. For DatProf, we've chosen a different approach for synthetic test data. We see it not as an alternative or the future of test data, but as a technique besides masking and subsetting for creating the best test data. So the approach that we've chosen inside our software is supporting generation sets, generation data sets for specific test cases in which you don't generate the complete data model, but maybe a fraction of the data model. So maybe 4, 5, 10 tables, which makes it far more easier to generate. Also, the solution that we've built is fully compatible with .prof runtime. So you can automate the generation of data directly from your .prof runtime portal and also integrate it, for example, with your CI/CD pipeline. What we did with generation is that we directly generate the data inside your database. So it's directly available inside your application. You don't have to hustle with indexes, with triggers, with constraints, or upload CSV files yourself. You're also not limited by the API of your application. It's directly available. And the best part is it's directly available for all of the major databases. So you don't have a tool specifically for Oracle and for SQL Server and maybe a different tool for Postgres and maybe some SQL scripts for MySQL. You have one uniform data generation tool for all of them. So how does it work? How can we generate synthetic data in .prof Privacy? Well, there are actually two methods of creating synthetic data. The first one is what we call synthetic data replacement. And this will generate synthetic data to replace existing values inside an existing database with existing data. This is not the topic of today. This is part of our default data masking functionality. Today we'll focus on the second method, which is actually generating new non-existing data. That can be even in an empty database without any data. So typically how you would configure it is by going into Privacy, create a new template or use your masking template, it can be combined, and import the metadata of your database. So you import the tables, the columns, the data types, the relationships between the tables, and then you will create different generation sets for the test cases that you have. And those generation sets consist of a couple of tables that are required for a specific test case. Next, you can deploy it directly from Privacy. So it connects to the database and directly inserts the generated data. But you can also choose to deploy it using runtime. So in that case, you would generate a package and upload it into the web UI and run it from runtime. Or integrate it, for example, with your favorite CI/CD pipeline, which it automates using the runtime API. All right, then it's now time for the demo. I will switch to my demo environment, and I have to switch the screens. So let me minimize this one. I will stop sharing this screen. And make that even bigger. All right. So what you can see over here is .prof Privacy for the customers and the users that already have it. It's familiar. It's the same tool. And I will not create a new project. I will open up an existing project. So let me go to the screen and open up an existing project. So an existing project like this already has a connection. It's in this case a virtual machine running on my laptop. It has a connection to it. I've already imported the metadata of this database, and I can also visualize the imported metadata. So as I said before, this is a really simple data model. And for this demonstration, we will generate data for customers, customer history, orders, a couple of tables. Nothing special today, but just to give you an idea how the concept works. So the users that use Privacy before notice that there is a new area over here. So typically we have project settings, masking and deployment, but we've got besides masking, now we have also got generation. And within generation, you build generation sets, and generation set consists of multiple tables that can generate data. So a table can be in multiple data sets. That's not an issue with maybe specific criteria on how to generate. I can easily create new generation sets over here. I can even clone a complete generation set and make some changes, for example. But in this case, I will focus upon the first generation set. It's the test case one for customers with no discount. It consists of these tables. I can easily add one over here. And what you can see over here is that it will generate like 15,000 customers with 30,000 contracts, with 6,000 tasks, with 30,000 orders. And if I open up this customer, you can see all the different attributes and also the different generators that are already present on this column. So what you have to do to actually generate specific data for a specific table is you go into the tables, you define how many records you want, if you want to truncate it before. In this case, it's already empty, so I'm not going to truncate it. And you have to specify for all of the columns the different generators. And we've shipped privacy with a lot of generators. Really simple ones, for example, a sequential number generator, which will start with a certain number and increment it by one. But also some more advanced. So for example, last name is generating last names, and this one is country specific. So we ship it with, I think it's 11 different languages. You can also easily add your own language if it's not present. But in this case, we will generate US last names. You can also do that last name for partner name, for example, but the difference for partner name is that the null values can also be set. So in 88% of the cases of the customers, the partner name will be zero or null. And in the other case, it will generate also a US last name. There are some more complex ones like generating a valid IBAN account number. This one is using, for example, a custom seed file. So this custom seed file is a CSV file that contains two columns, a first name and a corresponding gender. So in this case, I'm using this seed file to actually generate data in a consistent way for this first name over here and also for this gender field over here. You can see it shares the configuration. You can also do things within the database. So for example, pick the last name that we generated and use the upper function, for example, to manipulate this generated last name, or in this case, to even combine it with a partner name, with a last name, with a dash between and a partner name. And if partner name is empty, just pick the last name. We are generating companies. This one is cool. This one is the weighted list. So you can make a list of different properties and you can give a weight to it. So in this case, 90% of the data will be civilian and 10% of the customers that we generate are military guys. So what about foreign keys, you may think? Well, let's open up contracts, for example. And contracts, you can see over here with this special link icon has a foreign key. And we've placed on this one, on the customer ID, a foreign key generator, because this foreign key is referencing to the customer table. Privacy is smart enough to detect if if you are choosing a foreign key generator on top of this table. If the parent of this table is inside this generation set, it will pick IDs that has been generated for this customer over here. Let's say we've placed the foreign key generator customer ID over here, but customer was not part of this generation set, it will automatically fetch the data that's already present inside the table. So you don't have to worry about that. You can choose to use foreign keys that you have generated before or maybe that are already present inside your database. So you can easily combine it also with existing data. There are also some other smart functions, for example, the generator expression. With the generator expression, you can combine different generators. So almost all of the generators can combine inside the generator expression with a syntax like this. In this case, it's calling the regular expression generator with a specific regex that results in strings, six characters between A to C or 0 to 9. So you can easily copy specifications. So for example, if I want to just copy this specification over here, I can go to another table and say, well, paste it over here. What you can also do is not only on a column level, you can do this, but also on a table level. So for example, if I go to customers, I say copy generator specification. Maybe you have customers also in another generation set. You don't have to configure all the properties again. You just copy paste them over and over the other one, and you have the complete data set, complete specification set over there as well. And you can also do that by cloning a generation set. So for example, if I want to clone this one, I've got a copy over here with exactly the same property and generator specifications. So how can we deploy this one? We can do it directly from Privacy. I will show you in a second to deploy it from Privacy. And then we're going to switch to runtime and execute it using the runtime platform as well. So we go into deployment, we press start. It says this database, are you sure you want to generate against this database? Well, I'm sure. And now the software is actually connecting to the database. It's a VMware running Oracle on my laptop. So performance wise, it's not ideal, but our solution is pretty fast. I think it's on my laptop, it's like 70,000 records a second. So what we see over here is in the preparation phase, it will make sure that all triggers, all constraints, all indexes are temporarily bypassed, so we can easily insert the data into the target table. It's running in parallel, so we are generating 15,000 customers in one generation set, and also 15,000 customers in another generation set that can be run in parallel. Of course, the insert will be done not in parallel. And it's almost finished right now. It's restoring all the foreign keys, all the indexes, so the database is in the same area than before we started this process. So I think it was around maybe 1 minute that we've generated like 30,000 customers with lots of contracts, lots of orders, lots of tasks, and maybe we can take a look inside the demo application to actually get a look and feel on how the data is generated. So let me minimize this one. And this one is our demo application. I will log in and I will switch to the test 2 schema and go to the customer tab. So what you can see over here is all the generated data. So we see valid bank account numbers. We see consistent full last names with last names and partner names. We see valid date of births. The gender does correspond with the first name, but we can also see contracts over here. Contracts has contract details that belong to this contract. So in like a minute ago, we've generated lots of test data for specific test cases that we can use inside our application and our test framework. So how can you do it using runtime? Well, I've got runtime also running over here. Let me refresh to check if the session is not expired. No, it's not. So we've got synthetic test data over here. So it's an environment that I've already uploaded. The packets that you can generate from runtime, from Privacy. So for the people who doesn't know Privacy very well, what you can do within Privacy is say project and then generate for runtime, click generate again, and this will create a package. And this SIP package contains all of the logic on how to actually generate the data or mask data. And this package can be uploaded inside a runtime environment. So this one is already containing an environment. Of course, I can choose to upgrade and browse to the SIP packets, but in this case, it's the same package. With runtime, you have a central test data platform in which you can execute, monitor, automate all kinds of test data related tasks. So you can subset, you can mask, and now you can also generate data. I can do it by clicking here, generate, or use it from the self-service dashboard. But what you can do also is use API calls to actually generate data. So on my desktop, I've got a really simple PowerShell script. It's called start generation. And of course, this can also be a call not from PowerShell, but from, for example, from Jenkins or Azure DevOps or your favorite CI/CD pipeline tool. In this case, it's just a PowerShell script that calls the runtime API. Let's run it, run with PowerShell. It's already closed, and in the background, we already see that runtime is actually running the synthetic test data framework and generating actual data into the database. We can go into the environment to actually monitor the different tasks that are being executed. So what you can see is the monitor over here. You can see it's running in parallel, and it's actually generating the data directly live into the database that we can use later on. It's the same generation set, so it's almost finished. A couple of seconds remaining. It's now restoring all the foreign keys, and it's finished right now. Well, it may be short, lots of information. This concludes this demonstration and brings an end to this webinar. We will send the recording and also a technical white paper of synthetic test data to all the participants of this webinar. I see that there are some questions in the live event. I will make sure that those got answered by email. And then I want to thank you all for joining this webinar, and hopefully I see you next time. Bye.